Hello, welcome to another podcast with the University of Sunderland. Today I am with Adam Corbally and Ira Wimpenny. So we're going to be asking loads of questions today about business, education, learning, entrepreneurship, future plans, inspiration, motivation. But first, Adam, you're on The Apprentice. Can you share a bit about your background, what led you to participate in it?
Well, I think like most people, I used to sit there watching it, screaming at the TV. You know, where did they find these idiots? I could go on this show. I'd smash it. I'd be absolutely brilliant. Yeah. And then I kind of went into dad mode, I suppose, and ended up pausing the TV. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. And telling everybody in the room how bad these guys were, how brilliant I'd be. And that's when my kids were like, you know what? Why don't you put your money where your mouth is? And why don't you go on it? So I applied. And next minute, it all happened very, very quickly.
So how long did you watch it? How long have you been watching it before you actually decided to go on it?
So I had watched it for 6 years, and it was in the seventh year. So the first 6 years, it was a 100 grand job offer. Wow. That's what you got if you won. And you worked for large sugar on a 12-month contract, 100,000 quid. You had to move down south. And that was the deal. In the seventh season, they changed that to a £250,000 investment.
Yeah, that's when they changed it all.
And the 50-50 partnership. And this is when I got excited. That's and I was like, now that's what I want to be a part of. I want the business side of it. I want to learn from him. I want the mentorship. The 250 grand, of course.
And that's a nice bank balance to start a business with.
Oh, wow. Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
I mean, like, how did the experience on the show, like, shape your career and kind of, like, everything kind of, like, regarding that kind of, like, personal side as well?
I went on it to show, to fly the flag for the Northerners, really.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah, to show that, do you know
that's
what?
That's a nice gesture.
Yeah, to go on.
Not just all about you.
No, absolutely. And do you know what? I sort of thought, right, I'm gonna do really well. I didn't expect to win. As the week's gone on, do you know, the car's getting emptier and emptier. Mm. Before you know it, I'm driving around on my own and I'm thinking, I'm in the final five here.
Yeah.
So it was pretty scary. And do you know what? It did a lot for me. I learned a lot. I made a lot of contacts. It was a brilliant springboard, a brilliant platform, if you like, really, to sort of showcase the skills I'd learned through having businesses of my own and how transferable those skills were to go on to try some brand new things that were completely new to me and completely out of my comfort zone.
Of course, of course. Ira, do you think you'd be very good in The Apprentice?
I have been told I should go on it.
It would be brilliant.
But I don't know. Similar to Adam, I've watched Apprentice and I've yelled at the screen going, what are these people doing? So I like to be the one that teaches. So rather than being on the TV, I'm teaching the next generation to try and get them right. My background, I have my own business as well, so that's what I try and bring in the classroom. It's what Adam said. I think there is a misconception that to be at the forefront of business or, you know, the economic sector, you have to be in London.
Yeah.
And I think that's refreshing to say, no, actually, there's a lot of talent and a lot of ability in the Northeast, and there's a lot we can do. So as much as I would love to, I think if there was a new version of it, because I'm not finished now, maybe, I may be tempted. Mm. But for now, I'm glad I missed it, I guess. Leave it to people like Adam to take over and show what we're made.
We're doomed.
No, absolutely not.
I mean, like, obviously, like, London is like an interesting topic because, like you say, a lot of people would probably think that most opportunities would be found in London. But, like, of all like the challenges that you found on the show, like, what was one in particular that you found like the most challenging?
The biggest challenge had to be the final challenge. And, you know, I was a market trader, down the market every day, had the gift of the gab, get your greens, get your beans, get your nectarines, you know. I was happy and I was confident with people. And then the task was to pitch on stage, to present our business idea. Yeah, the dread. Someone dies every year and leaves the soul on that stage. And unfortunately, Jack, I was that guy, mate. Oh. I crumbled in front of 200 people, live in the room. It was, you know, cameras everywhere. Yeah. They even had the camera on the little train track going by. And I think that was sort of the final moment when I just gulped. I looked into Sugar's eyes, he looked into mine. And I got a complete stage fright. I fell apart. My heart was pounding out my chest. My hands were shaking. I forgot my own name. We've all been there at some stage. 10 million people watched that at home. And then millions watched it afterwards. And then people were making me into memes. But do you know what? It was the best thing that ever happened to me. Because from there, I dusted myself off.
Yeah.
And I learned from the best and became a motivational speaker. So if there's anyone listening that's struggling, if there's anyone that's had a nightmare, a murderer, a terrible experience, you know what? Hey, you can learn from it. It's not the end of the world. It never is.
What do you think that you took the most from being actually on the show?
I suppose it broadened my horizons. Okay. It gave me a different perspective on things, and it made me realise there's a big wide world out there. I'm born and bred in Glossop, small market town in the northwest. And you know, all of a sudden I'm beamed down into the capital. Yeah. I met different people, different walks of life, different places in the world, exactly like the opportunity of university, really. Do you know what I mean? A lot of people who've never really been anywhere. Yes, you're coming to get smart, you're getting to get educated, but actually you're getting to have a look because there's a big wide world out there.
It opens up doors, and that's exactly it, isn't it? That it might seem intimidated, but going out of your comfort zone is a key thing, especially in business. I think there is no set formula of what you do and how you do it. And I think shows like The Apprentice are great that have shown people that actually it's about your actual ability. And I think you demonstrated that your background, like you say, fruit and veg on the market, you wouldn't think that would cut it in central London, but actually it's not that. It's your ability, your focus and your drive. And I think when students can see that and understand that, that's what we're here to do, is help them go, your dream can be whatever it wants to be. And university is just that launch pad, like you say, to kind of open that door.
Before we touch on to university, can you just like tell me a little bit about that? Actually, was a fruit and veg in the market? What was that about?
So that was my first ever business. Yeah,
really?
Absolutely.
Fruit and veg in the market?
100%. Yeah, I'm a local
stall, just
local
like
town outside. Come on now, rainy day prices. That's juggling nice. Apples, juggling pears. Yeah,
that, on your own, or did you have like people helping
that
you?
That was me. Started off 2 days a week. Started off actually knocking on doors, selling sacks of spuds around the estates. To people, you know.
And you just went and just kind of just started.
Start 2 days a week, retail down my local market. The winter came. When the winter came, the customers stopped coming. And then opportunity wasn't coming to me. I went out there and got some opportunity. So with the money that I made in the summer, we work hard for money. I believe your money should work hard for you. You know, don't blow it on stupid things. I went out there, bought myself a van. I did everything that you do in your company. I came up with a brand. I came up with a logo. I came up with a slogan.
All that stuff, yeah.
And I went out there and stepped out of my comfort zones, like you say. You know, the success we want isn't in our comfort zones. Did things that scared me, knocked on every pub, cafe, restaurant. Yeah. Built up wholesale round. Before you know it, I was serving over 100 pubs, restaurants, schools. I even got the order for my old secondary school, which was like a massive moment for me. Yeah.
Ira, we'll come on to your business in a second, but we're going on to university and stuff. So like, how important do you think business education in universities is for like aspiring entrepreneurs?
For me? Obviously, I'm a little bit biased because I am one of our lecturers here. So I would say it's really, really important.
Yeah.
But like Adam, I was similar. We kind of jumped in and figured out business as we went. But having that knowledge and that expertise is really set you apart because it saves you time. So that early learning curve, so me and you both had quite a harsh learning curve, kind of just throwing ourselves in. But the education saves you that pain. It saves you that bit of pain. But also, university, I always say to my students, it's a lovely bubble. Yeah. It's a time to explore, experiment and develop. So if you have a business idea or a side hustle, I've got students who have Etsy businesses and stuff, use the time at university and the facilities you have to really nurture and develop the ideas. So by the time you come to graduation day, which seems lifetime away, but on graduation day, your business is developed enough to go, right, now I can literally do that. And I've got a student who's literally in the process of like launching his clothing line. I met him on first day of uni. He's graduating next summer. And it's lovely to see that university gave him that time and that safe space to develop. And obviously, you've got all your lecturers pick our brains. You've got finance experts. You've got law experts. Pick all of their brains. Get all that free advice.
Yeah.
Get all that information of what you need to do in your company for free. Do it. Get it ready. So when you graduate, it's just all guns blazing.
Like one thing, like you're going on to the, into like the deep end and just like learning as you go. What does that bring to people? What did you find that brought?
For me, I don't know about you, Adam, but I would say it builds a bit of a thick skin.
Okay.
Like in the sense that I was figuring out as I was going, I was very lucky again. I had a business mentor through the university who, when I didn't know what I was doing, I could go, what am I doing? I've got a meeting. So I had that little safety net, but it was still figuring out. But I do say to my current students, I was like, that was because I just did it. But if I could know what I'm teaching you when I started it, I would have saved myself a lot of pain and a lot of 24-hour all-nighters. And I think that's the difference. It's not, you can't, either way is a perfect route into business. But if you're in a position where you can get yourself that skills and knowledge, you're just giving yourself a bit of a springboard to fast-track stuff. And that's, for me, I think that's the difference is that insight you get. I don't know about what you think, Adam.
I think university, I always say in life, surround yourself with the right people. We've got the best version of you. And the right environment to learn. And when you get them people around you and you get that environment and you get the resources and the facilities.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's like a perfect storm, you know.
What skills do you think are crucial for success? Like in the business world, like whether you are going into the deep end, whether you kind of come out after university, what like specific skills do you think? If you were to have like two specific skills, what do you think are most important or most crucial?
for me, starting, that's a skill.
Okay.
Starting something 100%. Is a skill. You know, motivational speakers, hey, I'm one. You can go watch them all. They're brilliant. You can read all the books. If you don't start, you'll never start.
Yeah.
And talking about it isn't starting it. You know, telling your mate about it isn't starting it. Talking about down the pub to your mate, saying people make things happen, people watch things happen, or people think, well, on earth just happened.
Yeah.
Make things happen. And the second one is resilience. Resilience. Okay. You know, not just in business, in life. It's not a bad day. You never know what good's going to come out of it. Look, I got fired, lost out on $500,000, failed at the final hurdle on The Apprentice.
Yeah.
Left my friends, my family, my business, everything for 8 weeks. It was a disaster.
Mm.
And look what came out of it, a brand new career. It's took me all around the world. I've spoke to probably 500,000 people now. I've made a difference in so many people's lives through having that bad day. So if anybody's, you know, just failed that big exam or just failed that big test, you're in the right environment. Ask for help.
Yeah.
Ask for help.
Aaron, what would be your like two specific skills that you think crucial that people might want to develop as well?
For my students, I always say feed your curiosity.
Okay.
Because in business, the people that push that curiosity, that's where the innovation happens. That's where the new sectors come out. That's where all the great stuff happens. So be curious. Don't ever. When we're children, we're really curious.
Yeah.
And then as we get older, we get conditioned to be safer and sensible and all of that stuff. And literally in my business classes, in my modules, I'm always in marketing by background. I'm always like, be creative, be free, just feed your curiosity. And another skill would be agility and adaptability, especially post what we've all been through in the last few years and all the way that the world of business is changing so much and has changed so much. Being able to be a bit like yours, thick-skinned, resilient, agile and willing to adjust and pivot. So don't put yourself in a little box. So again, I teach finance students, I'm teaching marketing, HR, all valuable pieces of the puzzle when it comes to companies, but don't just sit yourself in that HR box. So our program, we get them to learn marketing and they do all of the subjects, even if they're on a particular program, because you need to understand the holistic element of business and how each piece works together.
Yeah.
So being open, curious.
Be curious, ask questions, be childlike. Exactly. I talk about it all the time. Music to my ears, I love that.
Yeah.
Love that.
And I learned a saying when I moved here, shy bairns getting out. So don't be shy.
I love that.
Yeah. I love it. It's like I'm not
saying, brilliant. I'm not so what is it, shy what?
Shy bairns getting out. I'm saying it wrong, so I'm very sorry if I am.
Don't ask, you don't get.
So I learned that when I came here and I was like, I don't even know what that means. But when I've understood it, I truly embrace it. And again, it's part of
I say
be
means,
open, curious, don't be shy.
I'm always asking questions. Yeah. What does that mean? What does that mean?
I think I heard something similar, but I think it was like closed mouths don't get fed or something
like
that.
Yeah, so there's quite a lot of those type of shit.
But
if we're embracing our lovely northeast
space,
you know, it is all about the bends. Don't be shy.
Definitely.
You're going out into the big bad world, you've got to be ready for it and be bold with it.
What are some common misconceptions that you've encountered? If we could try to get specific ones, but like common misconceptions, but then debunking them as well.
Two massive pieces of advice that I got in business and I followed, and it was the downfall of my first business. Don't trust anyone. Terrible piece of advice.
I know.
But you'd be surprised, you know, years ago when that's instilled in your mind. Mm. Obviously, now there's a lot more information, a lot more advice, a lot more social media, people are a lot more well-connected. When I was born in 1979, I grew up in the 80s, that you're limited with the information and role models you've got. And it was don't trust anyone. Mm. And the other one, which is terrible, is if you want something doing right, do it yourself.
Oh, absolutely not.
Terrible. The best thing you can ever do is delegate. The best thing you can ever do is find people that are better than you to grow and scale your business.
100%. To add on that, when you ask what the key skills you need, delegation.
Yeah.
Miss that one.
Yeah.
Trust, actually,
delegation.
You run your own business. I've run my own business. It's like my baby. I always say my business is my baby because I was born in my head and now it's running and it's doing amazing stuff. But you need to know when you can't be what it needs it to be, and you need to know what it needs and when it needs it, and that's where the delegation comes in.
Yeah.
Knowing that I'm not the right person for this bit, I should be getting someone else to feed and nurture this business to grow it, whether that's financial advice, whether that's an HR resource, or whatever that might be, you need to be able to delegate. So that is a skill in itself.
Mm.
And being reflective in your practice to be able to say, this is where I am, this is where I want to go. And to get there, I have to be honest and say, I'm not the right person to get it there.
Yeah, of course.
Bringing someone in like Adam or bringing, you know, another expert. Mm. But that's what people around the world are for, and that's what it's for, is finding out who the right people are for you.
Good leadership and management is all about that.
Yeah. And, I imagine, in like the business, especially like, you know, with like how intense it might become and everything, there could be, there's always going to be like negative setbacks and everything around there. Like, what advice like would you give? So you said like, you know, delegate and like, oh, be resilient, like all the stuff you said so far. But like, if you had like a massive setback, I know you said like you had one from The Apprentice, and I can imagine it might feel like the end of the world if you get a massive, massive setback. But like, what would be like an advice you'd give to people that would be facing like similar challenges and situations?
Nothing is permanent.
Okay. Love it. Yeah, that's nice.
Dead simple. Nothing is permanent.
Absolutely.
You know, your position isn't permanent. Your failure isn't permanent. There's no, you learn from your failures. The feelings we have aren't permanent. Everything will pass. Everything will get better. If it's raining all day, you know what? Tomorrow it's probably not going to.
Yeah.
In fact, when things are going really bad in business or even in my personal life, I kind of get excited. Exactly. The more, the worse they get, because I'm like, round the corner. It's round the corner. It's coming. The good times are coming.
Yeah, so you can only go up after one point.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think it goes back to, for me, I'm really passionate about experience and reflection. Get as much experience as you can. And if it is, if you're having a bad time, reflect on it. Because a lot of people kind of go, you can learn from the mistakes and you can learn from your successes. And I always say to my students, reflect on both. Because if you reflect on the success, because a lot of them, I think they get a high mark on their assignment and they just go, onto the next module. No, analyze and reflect why it was so good. Because if I could give you a cheat sheet to success, you'd be like, give it to me. So it's the same as that. Reflection is what that's about. Find out what works so you can repeat it. And then if it's a bad day, take it as a learning opportunity. I can learn from this so I can avoid this pit hole again. And it's about that reflection, kind of going, like Adam says, it's not permanent. And I think in the last 5 years alone, we've seen so much change in the business landscape. And that tells you it, that literally, a flick of a coin, things will change. So don't feel like you're stuck in a rut. It's just a case of, you might need to be agile, pivot, adjust, tweak. That's all it is.
Yeah, that's really nice, actually. I mean, I can imagine, like, everyone have setbacks. I think those are, like, really nice because, like, regardless, even if you're not in business, nothing is permanent and, like, you know, we've learned and mistakes and everything. Like, that's actually really nice. I mean, I'm going to say that for myself. but, like, when you both began, like, getting into business and, like, starting to go into the business world and trying to become entrepreneurs, was there, like, anything in particular that, like, you know, drove you? Like, was there, like, any reason why, like, you were saying, I want to go into business?
For me, it was all about the people. So it was always about people, always wanting to get a job where I could talk, always wanted to get a job where I could meet different people. That's what I was passionate about.
Yeah.
And that's what I always say to people, you know, follow your passion, the profits will come. And it's so true. And what you end up with, unfortunately, a lot of the time, especially with the younger guys, I do loads of work in education and people are like, I want to get a Lamborghini.
They're thinking about six-figure salary.
Why do you want a Lamborghini? First of all, you know, and that's a whole another discussion. But basically, they're chasing the money first. So they're like, I'm going to get into crypto because that's big money. And I'm like, but you know nothing about crypto. You don't understand crypto. I'm going to go on a course. I'm going to do this. Well, why are you going to do that? And when your end goal is the money, in my experience, you will fail. When the end goal is what you're passionate about, the money will come.
Okay.
And it will... It's true.
And like I agree with that as well, because, and obviously I've evolved, my business is still running, but I've very much embraced academia and teaching it because I want to inspire that next generation. But when I'm doing pitches and stuff, one of the common pieces of feedback I always get is, your pitches are always really authentic and you're always so enthusiastic and passionate. And that's because I could literally talk to you about graphics and print and marketing for hours on end. I'd probably bore you to death talking about paper finishes because print is my background. But that's what I love, and that's what the client sees. That, my God, Ida could talk to me about 5 hours about how we could do something for my company. And that level of passion is what gets me the contract.
Personal
passion. I've got clients that I've worked with for 13 years, and you don't manage to keep a client for 13 years if you're not doing it well and you're not doing it with passion.
The only thing we've got against the competition, which is AI, and the competition is there, and the competition's getting smarter and quicker and bigger and faster every day.
Does that keep you motivated? Because like, there's like the question of like always staying motivated when like, because people always say like, oh, I've heard that like if you're not moving forward or you're static, like you're moving backwards, like you know, kind of those type of analogies. Like, how do you kind of stay motivated to like keep moving forward, keep pushing forward?
Competition's great. Competition as a business is great. Okay. People always...
Oh, it's not scary, though?
Competition brings you A-game. Not just in business, in life. Okay. Yeah, you've just been telling me about you and your missus are going off to wherever. I don't know how long you've been together, but we've all been there when your missus comes home from work and she starts talking about the new guy. You know, hey, the new guy, Dave. Oh, he's a lovely guy. And then all of a sudden, Dave's name's coming up all the time. Oh, Dave plays football. And then all of a sudden, you start waking up. And you start thinking, I've been a bit complacent in this relationship. And then you're like, yeah, well, you know, I play a bit of football. I could take you to a game. No, it's okay. Dave's going to take me. You know, and then all of a sudden, we remember why we got invested in that situation in the first place. So I think competition wakes us up, makes us be present, makes us want to move forward, and brings our A game. So I know what it's like. I've had loads of clients with my coaching business where people will say, oh, there's a coffee shop open next door. What am I going to do? Mm. It'll bring you a game. All of a sudden, you're back on it. All of a sudden, you're invested. All of a sudden, you're present again. All of a sudden, you're looking at your menus.
Yeah.
You're seeing what you can do. Yeah. How can you bring in more revenue? Can you do deliveries? You know, can you do home services? Yeah. Can you do outside care?
For me, it's similar to what Adam's saying, that in business, you need competition. For a market to be healthy, you need the competition. We have different market structures because that is what develops. There's consumers for everything. So having competition doesn't mean you're out of business. So I always, the best example I give my students, because they get it, because you know, we have the students who swan in their designer gear. You've got the Gucci's, you've got the Primark's. There's an audience for both of them, right? So just because someone else exists in your space does not mean you're out of business.
Yeah.
It actually makes you thrive. It helps you find your niche and to really fine tune what your value proposition is and what you're giving to that customer and really understanding. And with AI, when you touched on it, I don't see it as a threat. I see it as an opportunity. Mm. Rather than be scared of it, don't run away from it, embrace it. We can use AI technologies to shape how we do business, improve our business output and strategies and operations to the point of being, again, taking our business to the next level.
Before we come, coming towards the end now, I actually just want to touch on that because so we were talking earlier about how like failing and how people would want to bounce back from that and learn from that and everything. So like, and you said, you know, welcome competition. But if someone faced competition and then they lost, how would you like? Would you say for people to still just like take the advice you had from a while ago of like to react from losses of like, you know, reflecting and just like resilience, like, you know, it's not permanent, or would there be other stuff like
the shoe didn't fit,
okay,
yeah, because it's like we don't always have the best answer or the best option or the idea isn't perfect the first time round. I remember many years ago when I was at the beginning of my entrepreneurial journey, I went to a talk and it was the guy that I think he owned Love Film or whatever, and he was talking about how many failed businesses he'd had, and it was just the fact that he was like, I hadn't figured out the right thing for me. So it's all the other things stand true, but again, it just might not be the right thing, or it might be the right thing at the wrong time. Again, I've had clients who had business ideas that were great, but they were too early to market.
Okay.
The market wasn't ready for that, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Or it might just be you haven't quite perfected what you want, and it's all about that value proposition. If you haven't perfected your value proposition, you haven't presented it correctly to the audience. And so it's never, I don't see it as a finite, no, I don't know about you. For me, that's what I think.
I think there's always a takeaway. There's always there's always something to learn. Every day is a skill day. There's always a connection.
Yeah.
There's always an opportunity to network. There's always something good that you will get out of it. And you might not realise it at the time.
Yeah.
But it will come full circle and you'll think, that's why that happened.
Interesting.
Yeah.
You know.
Before we're just going to close, you just touched on someone there, but like, is there any moment or like individual that like influenced your business or like life in general, like any moment, like you can think of in particular that like, oh, that's when everything kind of like changed.
24th of November, 2005. Very easy one for me.
Oh, nice.
My little boy was born. And that's when it all clicked into place. And that's when I realized what life is all about. And that was me then wanting to be, you know, dad, role model, everything. And that was the big moment for me. Personally.
Have you got one,
Not as amazing as that one. I'm trying to think, because I've never really thought about
that. What moment made you want to go into academia? I'm actually quite interested.
Actually, it was quite funny. I was running my company, and it was one of the people in our university. They kind of said, would you consider some guest lecturing? Because we'd like to get practitioners in to come and speak to our students. And I did it, and it was being in that classroom and talking to them about my journey. And I saw a few faces light up, and I thought, that was my spark. That's what I want to do. I want to help them figure out their dream. And then put that time into. I have coffees with my students quite regularly and go, right, what do you want to do and then kind of help them figure that out, because I had amazing lecturers. I was a student at the university, so I'm, again, a little bit biased, undergrad and postgrad here, but they were amazing. They shaped me into the person I am. They helped me figure out my business, so I want to do that for them. So for me, I'm a big believer in passing it on, and that's what made me come back to academia and kind of fall in love with it.
So everyone always wants to talk about what's next. What exciting projects are you currently involved in, and what can we expect from you in the near future?
So up in the Northeast, we've got some really exciting stuff going on.
Yes, we've got some exclusive sessions that we're working on with Adam for the university that will be open to schools and colleges, and some of our current students as well. So we can't say much more now.
Okay, perfect.
Lips are sealed.
Perfect.
But watch the space, watch the socials. You'll find out some more projects.
That's great. Well, Ira, Adam, thank you very much for coming on.
Thanks for having us.
So that's it. Thanks very much for watching. All content from the University of Sunderland can be found across all of our social media platforms.